Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf.
Hey, let's get to our play-by-play call of the day.
Nine to shoot, Joel jab step, move on Chandler, and now backs up, shoots it on right side, and it's good! A dagger, and Joel Embiid knocking down to three, and he motions with both hands, a three-point shot, 35 for the big man, sixes by 11.
You know what? I'm happy for that guy. I like him a lot. He had to broadcast a lot of bad basketball for years. The last 2 years, he's had gems to broadcast. I'm thrilled for him. Thrilled. And the Sixers now have Jimmy Butler to go with Joel Embiid, Ben Simmons, and company. All right. As you just heard, Kevin Flash the suit her. Or is it the bulletin that Le'Veon Bell shockingly did not sign? With that, we bring in Neal Coolong, who is no longer on airport duty.
Absolutely nothing has happened. Just like September, just like August, just like July when they started training camp. And it's not going to. There really is nothing that should make anybody believe that Le'Veon Bell on the day of the deadline, the last time that he can make himself eligible to play at all in the 2018 season, will sign his franchise tender and play for the Steelers this year. That's just not going to happen. We've known probably for a couple days. News came out that it sounded like his camp was kind of saying, nope, there won't be any deal. I'm not going to do it. But I think the real compelling issue with all of this is just whether or not he ever thought about it. Was this always his plan? I mean, there was information that was leaked, but it never was really very thorough or very complete. So you never really got a good idea that it was definitely happening or it definitely wasn't happening. It's almost like he just sort of put the feelers out there that he might to let the team know that he's still thinking about it to try to, strike up some type of conversation or dialogue with them. But in the end, he didn't get what he wanted, and he's not going to play. My thought would be there's a very strong possibility that he's not going to play in Pittsburgh next year either. So we might officially be done with 26 in Pittsburgh.
All right. So that's to bring to the next part. Obviously, early on, there was consternation about this. The thought was, he'll pull what he did last year. He'll show up before the first game and he'll play, and he never did. And then after a couple of weeks, everyone was still wondering when he would do it. When do you think that, as a football team, the Steelers started to settle down and just really start to put that in the rearview mirror and just play ball and not even worry about it?
That's what I mean. It's so hard to tell because there was just really so little information that came out from anybody. The players were tight-lipped about it. I find it hard to believe that he didn't talk to anybody on the team at all at any point throughout all of this, whether it's the team – teammates wanting to talk to him about what's going on, or just friends that he has wanting to check in, see what's up, or whatever. It just seems really bizarre that he cut off communication to everybody. So it seems to me like the team might have had an idea at some point earlier in the year. I wouldn't be able to say when, but their tune, by and large, hasn't really changed a whole lot. I think it was pretty authoritative at the start of the season, and that was, I think, because everybody, like you said, expected him to miss training camp like he did the previous year. I don't think the team really thought he was going to skip games. But after he did that, I think the thought really was that, just might not show up at all. It'd be great to have him here. It'd be great to not answer questions about this every single day. But, right. This is where we are, and we're going to move forward. I mean, there's not really much else for them to say after a while, and the reporters have to ask the question. So, I mean, I don't know. I think that's a good question, but I'm not sure anybody really had a specific idea in mind that he definitely was not going to play this season. I would even say up to and including Le'Veon Bell. It doesn't make any sense that he would have come back to Pittsburgh a couple days before he needed to sign the tender in order to play. There really wasn't a reason for him to do that. I suspect there was some type of dialogue going on with the team at a high level, but I don't think we'll ever really fully hear the details about it.
Without him, they've had to make some subtle changes as to how they play. Well, because, look, to his credit, he is a great talent and brings a lot to the table. What subtle changes have they made that have worked?
I think what's interesting is looking at not just the dynamic of the offense without Le'Veon Bell, but it's with a new coordinator as well. So it's tough to say chicken or egg in this case, but I would say that the net result is you're getting a lot more targets to your tight ends because you have more targets to spread around. It's creating more of an issue for Antonio Brown to get open down the field because he's getting more safety coverage perhaps than he did before with Bell because they had to commit a safety to covering him. That's opening up stuff, as we've seen, a pretty high target to catch ratio for Vance McDonald and Jesse James. We're seeing them more involved with it. And as the games are going on now, we're seeing Connor get more and more targets and catch more of his targets. So I think they've evolved consistently, not just from last season, but on a game-to-game level. And a lot of that, I think, is the natural maturation process of a team, especially a Steelers team, throughout the season. Their offenses have always gotten stronger. Their defense definitely has gotten stronger game to game. But with this, they've learned to succeed within the dynamic that they have, and they're doing it now at a point that I'm not sure we ever really saw over a consistent period of time. Baltimore, I think they left some points on the table, but they dominated the game by and large. They could have scored more. And overall, in this five-game winning streak, they're at, well, I think, like 35 points a game, somewhere in there. A good chunk of that is the Carolina game. But the offense has been very efficient. They're running well. They're passing well. They're not really turning the ball over. And obviously, they're winning games. So they're credit to them for changing what they have within their team. But I think they've changed it multiple times since week one, knowing you're playing without Le'Veon Bell and kind of figuring out the best way to use everybody.
One of the changes they made on defense was flip-flopping T.J. Watt and Bud Dupree. The interesting part is that they're now telling the world that Watt is now much more comfortable where he is because he's actually playing his natural side, and Bud Dupree is more comfortable now because he's playing his natural side. So, Neal, what the heck took everybody so long to put everybody in their natural spots?
You know, I shake my head when I hear that as well. That just sounds like the stupidest thing in the world, doesn't it? And probably because it is. There really is no reason that you'd sit two guys down and say, okay, you're on the left, you're on the right, and have both of them say, you know what, actually, I'm kind of better on this side. Yeah, you know, I'm better on the other side as well. No, too bad. Play these positions. I really don't think it happened that way. Whether they're being fully, completely honest about it, whether there was a different reason for it, whatever that might be. There might be a physical advantage the team feels one has over the other at a certain side based on tendencies of overall opponents. But by and large, if they're comfortable in the positions they're in now, it's impossible not to wonder why they haven't been playing in those positions. Because, yeah, both of them are playing far better than we've seen them play in the past. Watt in particular. I mean, he really looks like a player. I didn't quite expect to see him after what's it been with him, 26 games. I didn't expect to see him as a rising force, but he's playing really well. We're getting decent play out of Dupree. It's still probably a higher level than this team has gotten outside of a James Harrison outside linebacker since Jason Worlds. There's a blast from the past. Remember that name? We were talking about him and his ability to show up or not show up or sign a tag. We're way past that now, but he was the last one who's really been productive at that position, except for Harrison. And you're getting it from two of them now. It's great to hear that they both feel comfortable in the positions they're in. I just can't help but feel maybe a little time was wasted. I don't know.
A little. We've talked about various parts of the Steelers. One area I've not asked you about, we've talked, Neal, has been about the defensive front. How well have they played, and what kind of domino have they meant for the back eight?
I'll say this. I think either in typical Steelers fashion, they start the year playing one way, and then after four games of really not very good defensive play, they throw it out, start over, and simplify everything, and then play really well down the stretch. With that in mind, I look at Stephon Tuitt, for example. It's a player, he really made no impact early in the season at all, to a point where it's either just his role got easier, he figured it out, and he got hot and is playing really, really well like he is right now, or he was hurt. To me, it seems more likely that an experienced veteran player like Tuitt, maybe he was held back by something. And on defense in particular, that can tend to have a domino effect throughout the rest of one position unit. Cam Hayward has played much better. He's gotten a lot more productive recently. Javon Hargrave, I thought, has done a better job than where he started. So it certainly gives credit for the fact that a lot of guys have improved as the season has gone on. But the reality is they're knocking you know, quarterbacks on their butts pretty consistently now. We didn't see that before. They really hit Cam Newton a lot. I mean, yeah. I don't know if Carolina has the best pass protection scheme set up over there. Norv Turner had the same problem in Minnesota as well. But you really got production from them over this five-game winning streak. And that, in turn, quarterback doesn't have the ball as long to throw if, you know, he's getting chased down by TJ Watt when you're in the end zone. So he throws a boneheaded interception and you know, pick six right there. Those kinds of things are obviously going to help the back, you know, seven if your front three or four, whatever it is that you're rushing, are able to get to the quarterback. And for me, it really starts with that and the token, you know, throw out that they finally decided that Artie Burns shouldn't be on the field, and their defense has dropped by 11 points a game since Burns hasn't been playing. I don't see a coincidence with that.
No.
The combination of the two, a pass rush and non-Artie Burns on the field, they're recipes for success.
All right, so it's Jacksonville. They played them twice last year. They played them twice at home last year. They lost to them twice. Obviously, Jacksonville's a lot different. Why is Jacksonville so different this year than they were a year ago when you watched them?
They're very young team. They were a young team last year. They're certainly talented. I echo a lot of what Mike Tomlin said in his presser today. They are still one of the best defensive teams in the game. They've had some gaffes here and there, but it's almost like these years got kind of flipped for them. You know, I think what they're seeing now is more typical of a team that is very young with a lot of talent with a new coach. This should have been more their 2017 season than last year was, but they still have that talent on the field. They're just having a tough time putting it all together. I think that's kind of the growing pains. You know, you have a very living on the edge kind of defense the way that they do. They're big time athletes, incredible athletes all over the field for them. If you get them motivated, working together and on the straight and narrow, they're going to dominate most of the people they play. If they're not together, they're going to have problems. And problems for them is giving up, you know, 29 to the Colts on the road, which, you know, not the best thing in the world. But again, they're still a top five scoring defense. They can get after the quarterback. They've got a lot of talent there. You know, Leonard Fournette, I think being out for a while hurt their running game to some degree, and he's a critical ingredient to what they're trying to do on offense. They don't have the quarterback that can really win games on his own. They need to get him help. So I think they've been inconsistent in that regard. They've had some key injuries, but it's a huge, huge game for the Steelers, and, you know, maybe to some degree better off if they don't play Jacksonville and Pittsburgh this year.
Right. What's your thoughts on Bortles?
We've seen enough of him to kind of know who he is. I think his ceiling is kind of like an Andy Dalton level guy.
Okay, I agree with that.
He shows that he can play the game at a high level. He's not Nate Peterman, a new all-time low. Nate Peterman was worse than quarterbacks back in the 20s when the ball was the size of a basketball. You know, he's a worse passer than they were. Bortles is not at that level. I think he is an adequate NFL starter. If they scheme things right for him, if they can get the running game going, he's capable of making plays down the field. But I don't think he's good enough to win games on his own. I don't think he's good enough to really lead the team back from, you know, down 10 in the fourth quarter. I don't think he's that kind of leader, and I don't think he's that level of passer. So it might be one of the easier quarterbacks they've had over the last couple of weeks. So, I mean, that's a valuable asset for them.
Well, the Le'Veon Bell saga is near an end, and I'll make one quick statement about it, Neil. All kidding aside, there's no contract he will sign that will make up for losing $14.5 million. There's no way he can make up the money.
Which is why I also think it was interesting that Mike said during his presser today that there's a business element to this game. Even when we don't understand it, we have to be prepared for it. I think that's kind of a quiet shot that, what are you doing? regardless of whether you think the Steelers offered you a fair deal or not, regardless of how much you want to protect your body, ask Dez Bryant what happens when you don't play football and then come back and start to play football, okay?
Good point.
He's running that risk. He's running that risk, and he will be without football for a much longer period of time than Dez Bryant was.
Exactly.
So with that in mind, yes, there is a level of protection that I understand, but there comes a point that you need to play football in order to make the money that you want. And now he's not going to have any film from 2018 at all, and he's going to want to go out and make more money than Todd Gurley, the reigning offensive player of the year, makes, plus the $14.5 million they didn't make this year just to break even on what he thinks he should have gotten.
Exactly.
So I don't understand the strategy, I've said this the whole time. It's his head. It's not mine.
Exactly.
I get where he's coming from. from that perspective, but there's, in my mind now, there is just as much risk that he hurts himself at practice than there will be that he hurts himself on Sunday.
Exactly. Neal, always a pleasure. Appreciate it very much.
Definitely. Thanks for having me.
Neal Coolong, USA Today. We'll come back with more in a moment as we continue on News Radio 1070 WKOK, brought to you by our good friends at Sunbury Motors. Great to have you with us. That is the suit on guitar at a karaoke bar in Shamokin last night. His versatility really is almost stunning. I mean, you know, he doesn't like to brag. Oh, wait. How wrong am I?
Yeah, picks the spots.
Like every spot. What are you, what are you talking about? I came up with this idea. You mean the one I told you? I got to give him credit. Whenever somebody else comes up with an idea, he has a way of making it seem like it's his own.
Man, that sounds great. I'll run with that. Let me tell you what I came up with. Wait.
Roger, you won't believe what I came up with. And the odd thing is Roger can't. You'd be amazed at how smart management actually is.
Yeah, we had quite a few in the building today. Rog sends his best to you, and Greg Wetzel stopped by. Hey, we got a golf update. Wetzel shot 82 today. The number's getting lower.
Well. Well, boy, that's an impressive number. I got to give him credit on that. That is an impressive number. Wow.
He said, I had to get one more round in since the weather's going to make the turn earlier this week. I'm sure he's going to get back out to shooting.
Oh, boy. Well, that's pretty impressive, actually. I got to give him credit. That's pretty good.
He said, I hope to see you December 5th. I said, I hope so, too.
Well, there's only one obstacle I've got. Remember last year what a good time we had?
Had a blast.
Now, what were a couple of the key ingredients?
Let's see. You know who was not there, but you kept telling him, just show up for a little bit. You'll be fine, even though you had to go, even though he had a game plan that night.
Yeah, but that was just me trying to get us cover. Oh, no, we encouraged him to go.
We did.
It's not funny.
It was an away game, too, so that was a decisive factor.
Well, I feel like we caught every break last year.
And then came 2018.
I do appreciate the fact the station, I think, probably did this so I could go, but...
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Care, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Great to have you with us on the show today. Thanks to Neal Coolong, Glenn Macnow. Glenn, of course, on the Philadelphia Eagles, who's on the pregame show, which you hear on Eagle 107. This week they have the New Orleans Saints. That is a tough, tough assignment. And, of course, our thanks to Neal Coolong on the Le'Veon Bell situation. Troy sent a quick email over. Let's see. Would you be surprised if Le'Veon Bell is just a guy who doesn't love football and chooses to retire? It's baffling. Troy, I think that's an interesting comment. I can understand why you'd make it, so I'm not... discounting what you're saying. I think in the end, the money means something to him. I think he wants to get a long-term deal with some guaranteed money to set him up for life, but maybe you're right. Maybe he just doesn't love the game enough to come back and do it. I don't know. We'll find out how the free agency part plays out. Like I said, Indianapolis and the Jets are the two that have the greatest cap space. But, Troy, your comment is certainly worthy of absolute consideration. Maybe he just doesn't love it anymore. All right, let's bring in James Kratch, who joins us now from NJ.com on Rutgers. First of all, James, welcome. It's great to have you with us today.
Thanks for having me.
Okay, what has gone wrong for Rutgers and why?
Where do we begin? Basically, it's a young football team, and honestly, you know, they started the season and went over Texas State. You expected that. They got blown out of Ohio State week two. You expected that. And then the season just kind of really fell apart with a blowout loss to Kansas. You come home, get blown out by a Buffalo team that has turned out to be pretty good, but still, right. You know, a Big Ten team should beat a MAC team at home. And then at that point, they're 1-3, and it just kind of is all kind of falling apart from there. They had a close loss to Indiana, close loss to Northwestern. They got hammered by Illinois and Maryland, which really no one, I think, expected coming into the season. And it just kind of, and once you got past the first eight games, knowing that you had this back end of Wisconsin, Michigan, Penn State, Michigan State, it's just kind of everything's gone wrong. They haven't been healthy. The passing game has never really developed. They turned the ball over a lot in the early part of the year. So basically, I think the whole season kind of derailed in those first 4 weeks when they lost to Kansas and Buffalo, and they just have never recovered.
What do the coaches tell you in what they see in Arthur Sitkowski?
They see a very talented kid. I mean, I think they still believe that he is going to be, you know, one of the best quarterbacks the Rutgers has ever had. He's one of the top recruits they've ever had in terms of the various rankings. They think he's grown a lot these past few games. He's making better decisions. I mean, he still, you know, looks like a freshman in the sense I think he locks onto his receiver sometimes off the snap. They like what he's done. They think that early in the year he was trying to make too much happen. That's why he has all those interceptions. That he still might be near the national lead in picks. If he might not still be the leader with 16. But coming into the Michigan game, he led the Big Ten with the most pass attempts without an interception. So he's been a lot better protecting the football right now. They think that this year is going to be invaluable and that he's going to be able to make a major step forward next year as a sophomore because he's going through these growing pains. But I think in hindsight, his struggles early on were maybe a little bit more vast than people expected, and I think kind of contributed to that bad start that kind of knocked the season off the rails.
What about Blackshear at running back? I mean, Hillman transferred in from Boston College, and I was impressed watching him against Penn State in the Pinstripe Bowl 4 years ago. So what's allowed Blackshear to emerge out of that group? And then tell us a little bit about Pacheco, too, who ripped off the 80-yard run against Michigan.
Yeah, so Blackshear, the coaching staff, spring ball, has kind of considered him their best offensive player. And their goal coming into the season, basically every game, has been find as many ways as possible to kind of get him touches. They use him as a running back a lot. More so the past few weeks, they've used him as a receiver, kind of motion. He's a guy that you can put in the slot sometimes. You can have him lined up. You know, I think there's been a push lately from fans to maybe put him at wide receiver full-time just because the receiving corps has been one of the really disappointing parts of this team. This will make that step forward. But I don't think Blackshear, they haven't lined him up on a cornerback yet, and I think that once he lines up on a cornerback, you know, his ability is kind of going to be down because and he's a guy who's winning matchups with linebackers and some safeties. You know, he's not going to go win matches with cornerbacks. Hilleman's a guy who grad transferred New Jersey kid, and he was kind of the short yardage, grinded out workhorse back. But Pacheco was a true freshman, enrolled early. There's a lot of people around here who think he might be the best running back Rutgers has had since Ray Rice, that sort of ability. They brought him along slowly. He's kind of shown flashes here and there, and then obviously last week against Michigan, I think it was kind of the really emphatic, you know, flash yard touchdown run. He had a 20-yard return earlier in the game, two long kick returns that were brought back through the penalty. So I think you're going to see a lot more of Pacheco. It's been kind of building up to this point where Blackshear is going to have this kind of dual threat role as a receiver, as a rusher. I think you're seeing Pacheco. He's becoming the feature back, and he's going to be that guy going forward in his career. Obviously, Hilleman's got two games left in his college career. So I think they're still going to use him because, you know, he's been a good warrior for them and done everything they wanted. But I think he definitely, the past few games, has seen them sort of phasing Hilleman out and moving forward with the two young guys who are going to be back next year.
How much have they been hurt by the fact that Jerome Washington's been out?
I think it's been a big factor just because, you know, he was their leading receiver a year ago, And moreover, I think the fact that Sikowski has come to his freshman growing pains without a senior tight end with NFL ability who he can kind of rely upon. I think I asked John McNulty, the offensive coordinator, about this yesterday. I mean, a lot of times with a young quarterback, their best friend becomes the veteran tight end who has a way to get open and kind of be there if things kind of fall apart. He hasn't had that, and I think that's been a major thing that's missing from his offense. It's good in the sense that he's been able to develop a rapport with Travis Volkolek, sophomore tight end, who they think is, you know, I think has the ability to be a really good player down the road. That's going to help him going forward. But for this year, I think it's been a major issue because there were times, Kansas game, Kansas won, where it didn't really seem like anyone could cover Washington. But he just hasn't been on the field, and I think they've sort of hobbled together whatever offense they can, and it's not much with Rutgers this year without, I think, you arguably their best receiver.
I assume he's going to be out this game, too.
I think he was back practicing a little bit this week, so I think we'll have a better idea. Obviously, they practice on Tuesday. We'll see what he's doing, but I think it's 50-50. I would say they're probably more optimistic this week than they have been in recent weeks, but again, I mean, I wouldn't bet on it if I were Rutgers.
Defensively, there was a lot of stuff that happened with Rutgers. There's no need to get into it. Everybody knows about it as to what's happened. It seems like that's where the losses occurred with guys that weren't allowed to come back on the defensive side. How tough has that been for them to overcome?
It's been very tough. I think just because, you know, when you think about it, when you have 8 players in the summer, you know, some of them are still kind of in limbo. We don't know, you know, they might be able to come back to the team. Obviously not this year, but maybe next season once their legal situations are settled. It's really kind of unclear what the university is going to do. But that's 8 scholarship defensive players, and if you've got 85 scholarships, you're already basically talking about 10% of your team. So I think that's a major issue for them, and I think it's hurt them in depth just because the secondary has been fine, I think, for the most part. They lost Les Austin, their top cornerback, but Avery Young, you know, Pennsylvania kid, a true freshman, he's kind of deep end. He's had his struggles, but he's really kind of come on down the stretch. I think he's going to be a really good player. But the biggest issue they have is in the linebacker core, especially the outside linebackers and their defensive line. They have no depth in those positions, and they've really been hurting for a pass rush this year, particularly when you have your 2 best pass rushers. One's a backup defensive end, a redshirt freshman, Mike Turdoff, who's been kind of banged up, and Ellen Loomer, sophomore defensive end. Yep. He's missed a couple of games due to injury, and that's really been the only 2 guys who have given them any semblance of a pass rush this year. So I think that depth, when it happened, you know, you're going into the season, you want to be optimistic, you kind of downplay the loss, because most of those players had not really ever played for Rutgers. They were redshirt freshmen or guys who had been backups here and there, but I think in hindsight it was a major blow to them.
One thing that Rutgers has been able to do the last couple of years because of the presence of Jadarian Grant was that they can really gash you in the return game and create a lot of excitement in their own stadium with the return game. You know, you get to a 5th year, you do have to move on. So how far have they fallen back in that area because of it?
Yeah, I think that has hurt them a lot. I mean, they've had their moments, you know, but one of the issues, they've kind of had this revolving door because they've, you know, had a lot of brain farts, you know, whether it be fumbles or muffs or Pacheco, had one game where he just didn't feel the kickoff, you know, and another team recovered, or he tried to fair catch and dropped the ball and Rutgers took over at the 1. Their kickoff coverage team has been sensational,
right?
But their return game has left a lot to be desired. Fielded a lot of punts in weird places, or, you know, they'll fair catch a punt inside the 7, but then they'll let a ball bounce and get down at the 1. That's been a big issue for them. I think overall they don't have any explosive playmakers until Pacheco's kind of come on late. And McNulty said this at the beginning of the season, in college football, you're not going to have a lot of success every time to score. You need to put together a 10-play, 80-yard drive that's methodical, right? Because there's too many things can go wrong.
All right. How are the Rutgers fans dealing with this? What are the opinions that they send to you by way of Twitter or by email? What are you hearing from them?
The fans are not happy. I think there's a lot of fans are very frustrated with head coach Chris Ash. Obviously, you know, you go from 2 wins to 4 wins from year 1 to year 2. There's a lot of optimism. Now it looks like they're probably headed from going from 4 wins to 1 wins. I think people are upset. I don't think Ash is going anywhere. I think he's got the support of the administration. Financially, you know, it's well documented. He's got, you know, 4 years, basically $10 million left in his contract after the season. Rutgers still is not a couple of years away from getting that full share of the Big Ten money. They're not in a position to eat that buyout. I think he's coming back. I think there's a lot of frustration with this fan base, but they've played better the last three games, and I think people are sort of starting to, you know how it goes. They circle back when they realize that a major change is probably not coming. They start to say, okay, well, you know, these players look good, and Sikowski's making progressions.
Right.
But look, I think this game's a big one for them because, you know, it's not a rivalry, but Penn State really kind of gets under Rutgers fans' skin, you know, the whole kind of bordering state thing. Mm-hmm. I think it's senior day. It's the last home game, you know, of the season. I think there's a chance that, you know, if Rutgers is going to have sort of a last gasp and play over its head one more time this season, you would think this would be the situation. So I think a really good effort here could go a long way towards calming down, you know, the fan base and making them more optimistic as they head towards next season.
When you've had a chance to talk with the seniors, I mean, this has obviously been a long, winding road for them. Now, it did include a bowl game, by the way,
yes.
Long for them. So, I mean, people need to remember that. I think, did they beat North Carolina?
Yes, Lane Bowl, 2014.
Yeah, Quick Lane Bowl, yeah. So they've had that. But what kind of experience has it been for them? Because it really has been an interesting road.
Yeah, that's what they've kind of said. Chris Ashton said in his press conference, you know, they go to a bowl game. You know, some of them were there, you know, like when Rutgers joined the Big Ten, you know, and beat Michigan at home, all that excitement. The Kyle Flood era, which was just a disaster, and then now this sort of rebuild project that it looked like it was making progress but has kind of taken a step back this year. I think, you know, it's a small senior class. A lot of the guys they came in with are gone or went elsewhere. I think that it's a class that has played a lot and certainly a lot of three-year, four-year starters. And I'm intrigued to see what they have to say. Obviously, the next few days we're going to talk to them for the first time, kind of with this senior day focused practice. But at the same time, I just think it's a group that, for whatever reason, it's just never clicked for them. Obviously, they were very young with that bowl trip, and then the program has kind of taken a slide. But I think the hope now is that whatever they were able to do kind of laid the foundation for this younger group going forward, that there's a lot of hope about to kind of get this thing back to where it was maybe, you know, in the mid-2000s.
James Kratch, NJ.com. James, thanks a lot for your time. I look forward to seeing you Saturday.
You got it. Thank you.
James Kratch, NJ.com. We'll come back, wrap it up in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you. The other guy's way or the SMC way? The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
They're going to lose a lot of hat sales, t-shirt sales. Chiefs Rams going to where it should have been in the first place, L.A.
Yeah, Dick and I had talked about driving from Cancun over to Mexico City for that game Monday night. Then we calculated our odds of actually making it there. We're like, no, we don't think we're going to make it. But Dick and I actually talked about that. Hey, man, we ought to go to Mexico. No, I don't think
that
would be smart.
But it was explored.
The two of us, it took a second. That would not be a smart idea.
The DJ talks about all these venues and arenas that he has been in. I mean, the Estadio Azteca, they could have added that to his list.
He has never been to Mexico.
Wow.
He's never been to Mexico. I've only been to Mexico one time. It was Juarez. Not the best choice. But I had a rental car. Well, I'm in the rental car, and I was in El Paso. So I drive over to Juarez. Now I drive in. I'm like, okay, everything's cool. No problem. No problem. Drove back. Right? And then, my mom passed away years ago. But I remember telling my mom, she goes, "You did what?" I said, "Yeah, I went to Mexico." "You drove in Mexico?" "Hey, yeah." I said, "They have paved roads." "That was not smart." I said, "Mom, I'm standing here. It wasn't that dumb."
"Don't drink the water."
I didn't drink any water and then stopped to eat. Now, the players went over, too. They went over the bridge in the Juarez. And to be frank with you, it was an absolute education for them. And suddenly you had a group of players looking around saying they felt very fortunate for what they had. So, we'll go to Mexico next week. But Dick and I are like, we had to drive over from Cancun to Mexico City. And I said, "How far out do you think our car will get stopped?" He goes, "Oh, half mile." He says, "I think we ought to stay on the property." I said, "Yeah, I think you're right." Yeah. My goodness.
Well, this is on the Rams fans. Okay, it's on you. You get your game back, so fill the Coliseum up. No excuses.
You know what? To be honest with you, this is a great game.
Yeah.
And this is my point about this. Where is the NFL going to reap all of its benefits? I know they're trying to expand their markets. The goal is to be a $25 billion industry, and right now they're about $14 or $15 billion. So obviously they're looking at international markets to help them close the gap. But after a while, don't you have to do something to take care of your own markets? Don't you have to do something to take care of Jacksonville? Don't you have to do something to take care of the Chargers situation? Don't you have to do something to make sure that you have 32 stable franchises in this country? Stable markets in this country? Stable fan bases in this country? Instead of trying to, "Hey, we're going to go to Mexico City." Why? Why are you taking a market in Los Angeles where you really do need to stay on top of? The Los Angeles market, you have to stay on top of the entire time. Now, the Chargers are a total afterthought there. But if the Rams go south for whatever reason, then you're going to have a problem. Because, I mean, the Los Angeles market has been tough enough in the NFL to begin with. Now now the original plan was to take away a home game and send it to Mexico City. Honestly, I that stuff I don't get. That stuff I don't get. Hey, by the way, tomorrow is going to be early signing period for college basketball. But we'll get into that a little bit tomorrow.
Your station for news, weather, business, and CBS Sports Radio. News Radio 1070 WKOK Sunbury and on WKOK.com.